My first question to you will be, are you satisfied with your lecture yesterday?
I'm very happy by the way the lecture was received. We had a chance at the end to have some conversation with some of the organizers, I mean open conversation, and that was interesting questions. And then we also had time to get some in exchange with the audience. And I think there was what you call a connection, right, with the audience. I was very happy. I always, even though I spoke more than an hour, but I always feel I would have been able to use even a little bit more time, because my point is not to just shout the slogans of some kind and assume that everybody has to be in agreement with those. I try to give a reasoning why things I view things in a certain way. And I think for me it's very important to escape. For example, when I talk about anti-capitalism, I'm against capitalism. So I know, not only in Croatia, but especially in Croatia because of the communist experience, somebody thinks, okay, she's anti-capitalist, she's communist, as I understand communism. So for me it's very important to explain. For example, I'm not against the private property, I'm not against market in certain conditions, and then I have to give all these nuances, which make, I believe, the interaction good, right? That is not about things that are already known. But to do that, you need some time. So
as you mentioned, your critique of capitalism, Croatian media also thought that this is like the most interesting thing about your lecture, because it was on the news yesterday. Why is capitalism wrong?
Okay, I have a critique of capitalism on 3 points, and I call that an ethical critique, and I do that. Of course, it has economic, political, and social implications, but I'm a theologian and a physician, and that's how I came to be so critical of capitalism, is through especially my experience as a physician, when I had to study, and the Jesuits in Spain asked me to prepare a report about the pharmaceutical companies. And I was critical of them as a doctor. Any doctor knows that there are some practices in the pharmaceutical industry that are not in the favor of the patients, and they try to make money with it. But I never knew to what extent that was the case. When I had the chance to study that in depth, then I was appalled. I was astonished by that. And then it became clear to me that the system that allows that to happen, and to happen in increasing ways, needed to be wrong. So what I do is an ethical critique, and the critique has 3 points. And the first point of the critique is the fallacy, the falsity, the untruth of capitalist freedom. Many times capitalism presents itself as the defendant of freedom, and then others, communists, socialists, are then the defenders of equality. And we have a confrontation between freedom and equality. Well, my analysis is that this is wrong, because on theoretical grounds, I explained in the conference why theoretically, and that's from my Christian understanding, you cannot separate freedom and equality, but also the anarchist view, for example, it's a view that brings my freedom in exchange, in interaction with the fact whether you are free or not. This is not freedom understood as only individualistic kind of possibility, that I can foster my freedom regardless of what you are doing with yours. The anarchist tradition tells us I will not be free until we all are free. And I believe that's true. That's not an utopian thing. This is true because we are interactive beings. So how can you think of real freedom, which means to be able to express yourself as you are in a society full of tensions and inequalities? This is something that it's contrary to experience. But this is theoretical. And I mainly yesterday explained with concrete examples that capitalism from the beginning has not been the realm of freedom, because it has tried to bring the state to regulate in favor of the so-called capitalist interests. And this is not a matter of opinion. This is very clear in history that from the beginning protectionism regulated to defend certain rights, but it regulated, it had laws passed to avoid the workers to organize. This is regulation, and this is economical regulation, and regulation that doesn't happen through an invisible hand. It happens because some people have certain interests, have positions of power, and then get close to the people that are in politics, sometimes are the same family. One brother is the big business of the city, the other is the city mayor, and then they just have this type of policies being passed. Today, before you came for this interview, I was listening to the last talk of Joseph Stiglitz. He's an economist, Nobel Prize in Economy from the United States. And he has just published a book called The Great Divide of the Inequality in the Capitalist System. He said, for example, the United States, 2010, a law was passed that said the CEOs, the big directors of the big corporations, need to make public what they earn, their salary. That was passed in the United States in 2010. And according to Stiglitz this morning, I heard, now, 2015, this has not yet been implemented because they didn't make the regulation. This, what do you mean? To pass this law, you make a regulation that says CEOs should disclose the income, and that's done. How come in 5 years they didn't come up to do that? This is not complexity, intrinsical complexity. This is lack of political will. And that is very important to set the stage where we discuss against capitalism, because I absolutely reject the fact that capitalism defends freedom. That's not true. If it were like this, I would be capitalist. Because I don't want to compromise freedom. Personal freedom for me is too dear. I don't think anybody can fulfill his or her life as a freak human being created by God, and that I believe that everybody is. You cannot do that without what we call personal freedom. So I'm not at all ready to compromise. And my critique of capitalism is because capitalism presents itself as a defender of freedom, but during the history it has done everything but to defend the freedom for everybody. It has defended the freedom only for a few, and the right name of that, freedom only for a few, the right name of that is not freedom, is privilege.
What do you propose instead of capitalism? Mm-hmm. Because we have seen that socialism didn't work, mm-hmm. at least here.
Well, because here what has been the so-called real existing communism or socialism has gone out of the premise of the state ownership of the means of production. I'm not in favor of that, because we have the historical experience, but even if we didn't have that, there are reasons, and for example, I quote a philosopher that I study. Her name is Simone Weil. She died at the young age of 34 in London in the middle of the Second World War. And she, before the Soviet experiment got to be what we all now know, and when it was still at the earlier stage, and before many of the other experiences that now make that your sentence that didn't work for everybody since 1989, the fall of the Berlin Wall, is like, we all know that it didn't work. So at that time, not everybody thought like this. Some people thought this is going to be the future of humanity, to organize like the Soviet Union is organizing. But some people were already critical, right? And calling totalitarian structures the experience in the Soviet Union and not worker state, because the workers had nothing to say. That was, again, the most important thing for thinking a society that can fulfill the human needs is a society that gives the maximum of space for every person to really pursue their own thinking about how they want to live, how they want to run their economies. That sounds very liberal, but this is what I'm criticizing, that the liberals talk like that and then don't do it in reality. Then they back up a system that only does that for a few minority. And the great majority has their options in life shrink. So every time reduced. So what that would mean is, of course, I'm leaning towards a cooperative system that decentralizes the economy. But that doesn't mean I'm anarchist in the sense of I don't want the state to exist or to be at the minimum. I don't think the state has to be at the minimum. I think it has to be caring for this, ensuring that there is a possibility to do what I'm talking about now. And we need a state to ensure that. If you just leave it to communities, you'll have some communities just taking precedence over others. So I want a state that is able to provide for this network that allows then the people to at maximum self-organize. This cooperative system has been tried in some places, like in Spain we have a very famous example, it's called Mondragon, a cooperative in the north of Spain, that even within capitalism was able to function in a way that was very satisfying for the workers. And of course at the human level it's very different if you are working for a company and you have no say on making decisions, and suddenly they say, no, instead of working like this you have to work this other way, and you are the one doing it, but you have no saying on how this should be done. This is alienation. This is bad for the human being. That you don't like. Anybody likes that. So you just suffer through your work, you go home, and then you just feel a bit free. So this I don't like. Of course I don't like. I don't have an easy solution that it will give you all the formula, but I have four conditions that I think help us work towards that. So I can try to give them shortly. Okay. So the first one is what I call the activation of political subjectivity. So that means, who is the political subject? If you think, who is the political subject, maybe many people that are listening now will think, okay, the politicians, right? Subject means that you are the one who shapes the politics, so that's the politicians. I don't think so. In a democracy, if we really call it democracy, it means that the ones that are shaping policy are the people. So this needs to be activated, because this power, we have it. It's not that they have to give it back to us. The power, we have it, but we just don't activate it. We let other people make decisions on our place. So I think this is the first most important issue to bring a change that's for the good. And this cannot be activated only at the individual level. Then we have to organize. This is basic, right? That's the first point. Then the second point is what I call the unity in diversity. And I think the way to bring that into practice is what we call the constituent process. So what I would suggest in countries like my own, right? And I know every country has to find their own solution, and I don't think everybody has to move at the same rhythm. But what I am sure in Catalonia, which is my country within Spain, the best solution is now is to promote what we call a popular or people's constituent process. And that means to bring together the people who want a change, even if they want different things, and there is diversity, but we all agree that we want a change. So that should be enough to open up a revision of the constitution. And this we don't want done by experts, by jurists, by lawyers, or by politicians. We need to bring that down to the communities. And in every community, a discussion needs to be started. Well, if we could draft a new constitution, what would we want in this constitution? It won't come perfect, that I know. There is no perfection on earth. But it will be a way of starting to bring to fulfillment the political subjectivity without which democracy is empty word. So this is the project of a constituent process. And then the third condition is the urgency of all this. So we have to be very clear, why are we doing this? Why are we challenging capitalism? Why are we risking to make a new model? Because one third of the population is excluded. Because in Spain, 30% of the people are in the line of poverty, because children are suffering, because we have numbers of exclusion that are growing, because we have a divide between rich and poor that's unsustainable and can lead to violence, right? So this urgency has to be very clear. We are not doing that because we don't have anything better to do. It's because of the deepening consciousness. We need to know the real numbers of poverty, where the wealth is accumulating, and what in the future that can cause. It's very damaging, very serious. It can lead, like in France, to the rise of fascist movements that can lead to a very bad situation in Europe. So this is very important. So I don't have the solutions, but this is true. So let us take action. And the fourth one I have already hinted at is what Trotsky called the permanent revolution. Well, that's again to emphasize, we are not doing all this effort. I'm not proposing all this effort because, as I said, I have the magic solution. I don't believe in that. Whatever system we draft and we come up with, it will be imperfect system. So this idea is not, now we are in an exceptional situation. We are gonna activate our political subjectivity, we'll make a better system, then we'll rest. No. That if we want democracy, if we don't want abuse of power, if we don't want tyranny, if we don't want pseudo-democracies but real ones, we have to be ready to be activated politically and to remain activated. But that doesn't mean you have to all become politicians and you cannot do anything else. Maybe once a month you can just have some kind of responsibility. That's not too much, I think, to ensure a democracy. But without the popular responsibility, without the people's willingness to participate in politics, I see it's impossible. So how that should be articulated, there are different proposals. For example, all that, it implies the discussion at the local level of the budgets of a city, of any community. That's work, because you need to just look at all the possibilities of economical growth, and you need to allocate the budget in this or that way. But these usually the representative politicians do. So that's a possibility that some cities have done and have done successfully, to open discussions for that, and then to widen the participation on this type of decisions. So those would be four conditions or four ideas that help. No magic solution, no state ownership of the means of production, to foster this collective ownership. And let me just say another thing, which is, I am a nun, right? I'm living in a monastery. I don't own private property. I'm not against the abolition of private property, but I advise people to consider the possibility to just join with others, because this is, we have this fear that if you don't have private property, something very bad happens to you. Well, my experience is not, of course, I'm not saying everybody goes to a monastery, but I'm saying this, looking at the possibilities that you live without private property, well, that's not a bad idea. It's actually a very positive experience for me. But this, I never, never would back up a state that forced people to do that. Because I love this too much. This has to be a free choice. That has to be people within a society that incentivates, that helps, that believes in that, that talks about it. But people should freely engage in it and be able to disengage. Because at the monastery, I'm very happy. But if I came to a point where I was not happy, I could go back. I could leave it. So I don't like totalitarian state. I don't want anything to do with this. I believe capitalism under the banner of libertarianism, it's for many people totalitarian in the sense that they have no options. They have to act as other people have decided. Some of the things we can do to change the system, and they could be done right away, is of course to completely change this idea that the private property is an absolute right. This, the social doctrine of the church, has talked about it, and many other people, of course. Private property, if you want to maintain, and capitalism does that, if you want to maintain that private property is an absolute right, there is no way you're going to build a just system or a free system for the majority. For those who have no property or have less property, the options are less. So the freedom in that sense is less. So I said, I defend private property, but not as an absolute right. It has to have a social component. It has to be impossible for somebody in the world to pile wealth while other people die because he has what these people should have for living, right? Of course I'm against this, of course.
If we implement some other system that will give less to people, and when I say less, I mean in material way, in lesser wages, for example, will it happen that our experts will leave the country? Will we stay without our medical care, for example?
Okay, that's very important because that comes from this idea that we have diminishing wealth and we have to split that. That's not true. The last report of Oxfam, and this, I'm quoting these agencies because they are respected worldwide, and so these numbers are not something that I just make up, right? Those are numbers that everybody can go to internet and check. The last report of Oxfam Intermon says that if we continue with this capitalist system, in 2016, this is next year, 1% of the population will have accumulated more wealth, more richness, more property than the rest 99%. This, we have to pause, because those are numbers, but you have to pause and think, what does it mean? In the reality, it means that the wealth in the last years has been growing, but it has been growing for such a tiny part of the population that this, again, the accumulation, that's what the consequence of the system that we are having. This is what we need to address directly, without fear and in a very explicit way. If we do that, it is possible that in Croatia the doctors earn more and the people get more wealth shared, because the pharmaceutical companies are, for example, let me be very concrete, pharmaceutical companies with this Sovaldi medication, is a medication for hepatitis C. I don't know if in Croatia this has been on the news, no? Because in other places has been in the news, it's latest medication for hepatitis C, the viral infection of the liver. It costs one pill, 700 euros. 700 euros, one pill, and you need to take one pill a day at least for 3 months. This is the treatment cost, 61,000 euros, one treatment for one person. How can that be? Well, this is what it implies when you don't have a strong state that's able in front of this private company to just tell the company, we are not going to buy this pill to this. This is outrageous. We are going to spend all our money that we have to pay doctor salaries, to pay the nurses, and to provide for preventive medicine. We're going to give it to you, private company, because you are telling me one pill costs 700 euros. This company belongs to this 1%. So the company cannot say, come on, you don't understand. I am in need to put this price for this pill because I have invested a lot of money in producing it. That's what they say. But this is plain not true, because they would not be of this 1% that is so much thousands of times above anybody else. So this needs to be addressed directly. That's what I mean by anti-capitalism. If you do that, then you realize in Croatia the people are working people, they are intelligent people, they are creative people. Of course we can have a better society. And if some doctors want to leave, let them leave, because the majority will understand that if we are able to produce an economy that's viable, because of course if you fail and you have everybody without anything to eat, people will leave. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking of shaking off the fear that says, if we challenge these big corporations, we'll be bankrupt. This is what they told them, Iceland. Iceland, the Troika, European Commission and the European Central Bank and the International Monetary Fund, they call that the Troika, European Troika, said to Iceland, if you dare challenge our policy, if you dare not follow our advice and you do not rescue your banks, you will be in bankruptcy. You will go down and you will absolutely lose. People will go away from your country. You will be in the worst crisis ever. Iceland, because they are small, they are only 300,000 people and they are all relative from each other, so to speak, they said, we don't believe this. So they said no to the Troika. Now they are better off than Spain, than Greece, than Portugal, than Ireland, than anybody else that has followed the European. So let's dare challenge this, because this is a way of enslavement. And this debt we should take off as a necessary means for having a future that has the possibility to develop economically in a free way.